Welcome to part two of the Ultimate Beginner Spine Tutorial. This time, I'll be showing you how to prep your artwork for rigging and animating in spine. As always, you can skip to the end for a recap if you just want a quick answer, but otherwise, let's jump right in. To get the most movement out of your rig, you'll want to draw your character in a neutral pose with all of the animatable parts as separate images so that they can move independently from one another. Kind of like one of those paper puppets with the little pins in them. But if you're starting with a flat image, there are ways to prep the art without completely redrawing the character. I'll first show you how to build a character from scratch on layers, and then I'll show you how to cut it up if it's on a single layer. I'll be using Photoshop, but you can use whatever software you want as long as you can export your layers as PNGs. You might be familiar with character turnaround sheets, which show a character at different angles. These can be a great guide for making your artwork, and helpful if you want more complex animations. Here, I have a front, three-quarter front, side, three-quarter back, and back view. Depending on how your character moves, you might not need all of these views, and you can actually get a lot of good animation out of just a three-quarter front view. It helps to plan out and thumbnail the animations that you'll be doing later, just so that way you know what views you might need. Using your reference as a guide, draw out each moving part on a separate layer. Pretty much anything that has its own movement, like the different body parts, clothing, and hair. You'll want to think about your rig and animations at this stage. There is a bit of an art to rigging, and many ways to do the same thing, but there's generally two ways to move your art, using just bones or adding meshed weighting. Imagine the actual skeleton your character has and where all of its joints are. An arm bends at the elbow, so it might make sense to separate out two parts of the arm and just move it with two bones. But maybe you're going for a rubber hose style. It might make more sense to keep the arm together and make it one flexible piece using mesh weighting. All this to say, use your best judgment for what you need to cut and what to keep together. You can always go back and change it later if you need to. For reference, this is how I cut up my character. I wanted a lot of control over this character. So I cut the major parts into pieces, and I even separated fine details on the face, like the mouth, nose, brows, eyelashes, pupil, whites of the eyes, and eye highlights. But cutting it like this would have also been fine. You might notice that there's areas here that overlap. This is to make sure that there's enough art available underneath a moving piece so that the parts don't separate from each other when they move. For example, if we didn't add overlap on the legs, when her skirt moves, we'd end up with gaps in the art. This is important for pretty much every separated piece. Otherwise, you'll be stuck with a headache using some pretty tricky rigging techniques. Speaking of tricky rigging, it's often best to draw your parts in a neutral, straight position, so that way it's easier to rig. In my different views, the hair and the tail are drawn in a curved position for my reference when posing the character, but I might end up using the straight versions I've drawn to the side for rigging. Think of your art as the middle point of motion. If the art starts as a curve, it'll look fine going one way, but it'll probably be harder to make it look good going the opposite direction. But if we straighten out the art, now its default position is at the middle of the two extreme positions that we might want to have. Here's a few other tips for making art prep easier. Sometimes when we draw, things can look great one direction, but it'll look warped when you flip it. So make it a habit to flip your art periodically as you draw to make sure that it reads well in both directions. Then your character won't look weird if you want them to run in the opposite direction. The symmetry tool is great for making sure that your art is symmetrical when you're working on the front or back views. Instead of drawing five views from scratch, you can reuse parts from other views either entirely, like I did with the legs and arms, or as a starting point for making new views, like I did here with the head using the warp tool. This helps keep your art consistent and can save you a lot of time making the art. Because I did this with my character, my front view took me about 2 hours, but the other four views only took like 3 hours. So what if we want to use an image that's already been merged? Well, that's where the good old lasso tool comes in handy. Duplicate your image and lock it so that you've always got a backup in your file for reference, and then start cutting up the other one by selecting a section with your lasso tool and then pressing Ctrl J. This will duplicate the selection to a new layer. Then go back to the other layer and repeat this process for every moving part. It's good to work from the background to the foreground so that way you don't have to rearrange the layer order later. You can use the magnetic lasso tool to help snap the lasso along the edges of the art, but I personally find the tool a bit obnoxious to use, so I just stick to the regular one and get a general cutout, and then I'll go through the layers one by one and refine the edges using a combination of the loop and eraser tool. It's helpful to use an obnoxious background color for this part too, so you can see what you're erasing more clearly. Also, be mindful of layer dust at this point. Pixels that exist on the same layer, away from the artwork, but might not be easily noticeable. There's a pretty easy way to spot this. Right-click on one of your layer's thumbnails, and then turn on Large Thumbnails, and clip the thumbnails to layer bounds. Now the thumbnail layer bounds will only show the art on the layer, and it will be easier to notice when a layer has extra unneeded artwork. You can add a stroke to this layer and find any extra pixels that you might need to erase. And don't forget the overlap. You'll probably need to recolor areas that overlap so that way when the art moves, it doesn't just show the same art underneath it. This might be as easy as painting an extension of flat color, or it might mean having to draw out more complex art manually. Sometimes you can get away with using the content-aware fill tool to fix these problems. With your layer selected, first click this icon to lock the transparent pixels on the layer. Now, only the existing pixels will be recolored. Select the area that you want to overlap, and then go to Edit, Fill, and select Content Aware in the dropdown. Photoshop will then take the color information from the surrounding pixels and paint the area that you selected to match. It doesn't work for every situation, but it can be helpful for getting an area started, and it works really well when there's not distinct shapes around. Now, double-check that the prepped layers match the original image as best as they can. Toggle the original image on and off over top of the prepped artwork. If anything doesn't match, now it's a good time to fix it. And now that we've got all our layers, it's time to rename everything. Each layer needs a different name so that they don't override each other during the export. You can name them whatever you want, but it's really helpful to have a naming convention in place. This is my naming convention. I identify the character, the body part, the direction the part faces, the numbered part if there's more than one of the same thing, and then the view. So here, that might look like which underscore hair tough underscore left underscore 02 underscore front quarter. I usually shorthand this though if certain information is unnecessary. I also identify left and right based on the character's perspective and not based on the screen's perspective. That way, when my character's turning around, the left and right view will always be in the same spot in relationship to the character. And we're done! All that's left to do now is export the images as PNGs. There's a really great tool for exporting layers called the Photoshop to Spine script. You can download it from GitHub at the link in the description below, along with scripts for other Adobe programs like After Effects and Illustrator, and even for some free programs like GIMP and Inkscape. It's updated pretty regularly by some folks on the official Spine team, so it's good to check back every once in a while for a new one. To use the script, go to File, Scripts, Browse, and locate the script on your computer, and the Photoshop to Spine window will pop up. Ignore Hidden Layers will tell the script not to export any layers that are hidden in the layer menu. Ignore Background Layer will also tell the script not to export the background layer. When Trim White Space is checked, white space around the edges of each layer is removed, and when it's unchecked, all images will be the size of the PSD. It's usually best to keep this on for optimization purposes. Checking Write Spine JSON will create a JSON file that can be imported into Spine. This lets you import the art into Spine in the same position and layer order as it is in Photoshop, based on the PSD's origin point. By default, the origin point is at the top left corner of the canvas. But this can be changed by turning the rulers on, then clicking and dragging from this corner square to the place that you want the origin point to be. Checking Write Template Image will create a reference image of all the visible layers in your PSD. You can also adjust the export scale and how much padding to have around the edges of the images. The default output path for the images will be a folder called Images, wherever your PSD is saved, as will the JSON saved with the same name as the PSD. You can see the full paths here. You must save your PSD before running this exporter or else it won't work. And it's good practice to save all of your files in a project folder so things don't get lost in your desktop. Once all of the settings are to your liking, press OK, wait for the script to finish running, and you're good to go. If the script runs into any issues, like layers having the same name, it'll open a script alert to tell you how to fix it. The script also does some pretty cool things if layers are named a certain way, put into groups, or has adjustment layers. Check all those cool features out on their GitHub page for more information. And now we're finally ready to take this bad boy into Spine. But first, let's do a quick recap of all the important bits. Draw or cut up your character on separate layers. Turnarounds are great references for tracing over. Plan your animations ahead of time with thumbnails so you know what art you actually need. Separate anything that will move onto its own layer during animation, including body parts, clothing, and accessories. Your needs will vary. Draw parts in a neutral pose for better looking meshes later. Make sure every piece overlaps the surrounding parts so the art doesn't separate when it moves. If you're cutting up your art because your artist didn't work in layers like a big poo-poo brain, use the Content Aware tool to avoid manually painting overlap whenever possible. It doesn't need to be pretty, it just needs to be functional. Reuse as much artwork as you can across the different views to keep things consistent, and because we're lazy and we don't want to draw more than we have to. Flip your art periodically to make sure it doesn't look like trash going the opposite direction. Give all your layers different descriptive names like the good mommies and daddies you are. Download the Photoshop to Spine export script or whichever one you need on GitHub. Make sure your PSD is saved in a project folder and export your art by going to File, Scripts, Browse, Photoshop to Spine. Use these settings, wait for Photoshop's brain to work, and you're all set to use some sweet Spine skills. If you want to see a time lapse of the entire art prep process, you can watch a video of it here. And if you want to check out my files, I've linked them in the description below. Feel free to use this and follow along with the next tutorial when we finally get into spine and begin rigging our character. I'll see you soon!